We continue on our series through the book of 1 Corinthians, and this morning we're going to look at 1 Corinthians 4. And if you remember, the theme for our path, our journey through Corinthians is the story that we are consecrated, that we are set apart for certain things. In the first week you saw, we saw that we were set apart for unity, to be unified as one body in Christ, that we were set apart to be loyal, loyal to Christ, loyal to His service, to what He has called us to. And last week we saw that we were set apart for service, to serve God and to serve each other. Today we're going to look and see that we are set apart for even greater things, and that is to be leaders, set apart for leadership. And so as we look at 1 Corinthians 4, if you are able, I ask that you would stand as we listen to what God has to say to us this morning. And so hear these words from 1 Corinthians chapter 4. Hear these words. So then, men ought to regard us as servants of Christ and as those entrusted with the secret things of God. Now, it is required that those who have been given a trust must prove faithful. I care very little if I am judged by you or by any human court. Indeed, I do not even judge myself. My conscience is clear. But that does not mean that I am innocent. It is the Lord who judges me. Therefore, judge nothing before the appointed time. Wait until the Lord comes. He will bring to light what is hidden in darkness, and He will expose the motives of man's heart. At that time, each will receive his praise from God. Now, brothers, I have applied these things to myself and Apollos for your benefit, so that you may learn from us the meaning of the saying, "Do not go beyond what is written." Then you will not take pride in one man over against another. For who makes you different from anyone else? What do you have that you did not receive? And if you did receive it, why do you boast as though you did not? Already you have all you want. Already you have become rich. You have become kings, and that without us. How I wish that you really had become kings, so that we might be kings with you. For it seems to me that God has put us apostles on display at the end of the procession. Like men who are condemned to die in the arena, we have been made a spectacle to the whole universe, to angels as well as to men. We are fools for Christ, but you are so wise in Christ. We are weak, but you are strong. We are honored, you are honored, but we are dishonored. To this very hour, we go hungry and thirsty. We are in rags. We are brutally treated. We are homeless. We work hard with our own hands. When we are cursed, we bless. When we are persecuted, we endure it. When we are slandered, we answer kindly. Up to this moment, we have become the scum of the earth, the refuse of the world. I'm not writing this to shame you, but to warn you, as my dear children, even though you have 10,000 guardians in Christ, you do not have many fathers. For in Christ Jesus, I became your father through the gospel. Therefore, I urge you to imitate me. For this reason, I am sending to you Timothy, my son, whom I love, who is faithful in the Lord. He will remind you of my way of life in Christ Jesus, which agrees with what I teach everywhere in every church. Some of you have become arrogant, as if I were not coming to you. But I will come to you very soon, if the Lord is willing, and then I will find out not only how these arrogant people are talking, but what power they have. For the kingdom of God is not a matter of talk, but of power. What do you prefer? Shall I come to you with a whip or in love and with a gentle spirit? This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. You may be seated. I want to preface this message this morning with these words. I am coming to you in love and a gentle spirit and not with a whip. Okay? So if you feel like you're getting whipped, I'm sorry. That's maybe your problem and not mine. Okay? But no, the Lord's words are words of love. And so this morning we're going to hear what God has to say about leadership. Leadership is an important quality, an important thing in our world. We look and historically we see that sometimes we've had good leaders and sometimes we've had poor leaders. Sometimes restaurants, businesses have good management and sometimes they have poor management. And sometimes we go to a restaurant or a place of business, a business establishment that's a chain and that is supposed to have the same quality, the same kind of service, the same, because it's the same everywhere, and we discover that it's not the same. That one is, we enjoy going to much more than the other. That the service is much better at this one than the other one, and that actually we would rather not go to the other one. Even though they have the same name on the storefront, there's something different, something not as good in it, and we can oftentimes say, well, there must be poor management, poor leadership. They aren't doing their job. The same is true in churches. Leadership. We are a flock of people, a flock of sheep before God, and we are seeking His leading, His guiding. And so, sometimes a pastor can offer poor leadership because he doesn't listen to what God is telling him. Sometimes we as people in the flock can offer poor advice, poor leadership for fellow members of the flock because we don't listen to what God has told us and we give them our own words of advice. And so Paul is talking to this church in Corinth, and if you remember, one of the problems was that some had said, we follow Paul, who was the person who started the church. Others say, we follow Apollos, because Apollos came after Paul, and Paul wasn't, to his own admission, the greatest speaker. But Apollos was a polished orator. He could speak, and people would just listen. And then others said, well, we follow Peter because, you know, Peter is the only one of you that really spent time with Jesus. The rest of you discovered who Jesus was after he died. But Peter knew him before he died. And so we're going to listen to what Peter has to say. And then others would say, well, you know, Paul, Apollos, and Peter, they're all human beings. We follow Christ and Christ himself alone. And so there was this competition, and he talked about the unity, but in this competition that had arisen, there was a problem in the church in Corinth. After I finished my seminary career, one of the preaching professors taught students how to preach, and he taught them the four-page method. So each sermon has four pages. I only have two. But the four-page method was this. The first page is the problem in the text. The second page was grace in the text. And then he applied it to our life and said, now we take the problem and look at what is the problem in our life and how does grace apply to our life. Well, so I'm going to look at the problems in Corinth, because Paul is listing them. He says, you ought to regard us as servants in Christ. And so as servants in Christ, I'm going to tell you these things. These problems, the things that are wrong with you and your church. And if you continue in this way, this church is not going to be blessed. And this church is not going to be a blessing to other people in Corinth. The first problem that Paul points out is that they have been judging each other. They have been saying one is better than the other. And the Bible tells us that we are not to judge. Paul says, I don't even judge myself. And that doesn't mean that I am not perfect. That That doesn't mean that I have done everything right. In fact, I probably have failed as an apostle, as a herald of Christ. I probably have not done everything exactly the way God wanted me to. But I have desired to be faithful to my calling. And so when I stand before God as the judge, I have no fear. Because I know that I have been made righteous through Christ. And that in my dependence on Him, I have desired to be faithful. And so he said, God is the one who judges us. We should not be judging each other. The second thing he says is that you have become puffed up people. You have become proud in who you follow. You say, well, I follow Apollos. You guys follow Paul. You guys follow Peter. I follow Apollos. Sometimes I see that in churchgoers. Right? I go to such and such church. Oh man, it's the best church. It's our pastor is wonderful. Our youth leader is wonderful, and it's just the best. The best meaning better than other churches. One of the great blessings that I have had since I've come to Stephenville is that I gather in prayer every Tuesday morning with about 12 pastors from the Ministerial Alliance of Stephenville. And we are all part of different churches, different congregations, some small, some a little bit larger, but all of us about the same size. But we pray and we ask God to bless each other's flock. We pray together and ask that God would lead us as shepherds so that the flocks that we are shepherding would be blessed. And that the bigger flock, the larger flock, the universal church would be a blessing to Stephenville. There's no competition. There's no saying, well, you know, thank you for being here, Pastor Greg, but you know, you're Christian Reformed and Baptists just count a little bit more than Reformed people do in Texas. And none of that. We're all one in Christ. And so the church, the leaders in the church in Corinth had gotten puffed up. Now, when you puff something up, you have to take something from somewhere else. So if you have a balloon, I was going to take a balloon, but I couldn't find a balloon. If I would have a balloon here this morning, it would be, you know, kind of just a piece of plastic. But if I'd want to puff it up to make it look like what you would expect a balloon to look like, I would have to blow air into it, wouldn't I? Now, the balloon can't find the air by itself. The balloon has to have the air put in it from someone else or someplace else, and so I would blow up the balloon, and then the balloon would be puffed up. When we are puffed up, Christians, we take something from someone else or somewhere else and puff us up to make us look bigger than we are, better than we are. And so Paul is saying, you are puffed up. You are arrogant. You are proud. And he points out these things in verse 7. He says, what makes you different from anyone else? What makes you better than anyone else? Aren't we all the same? Aren't we all sinners? Aren't we all people in need of grace? Aren't we all needing forgiveness? None of us more or less than anyone else? And he says, all of you have and ever will be comes from someone. You have received everything that you have. It's been given to you. Now, we lose sight of that. That everything we have has been given to us. And we're sometimes we're not the best recipients. I talked to a family a while back, years ago, and they were a family that was looked up to in the community, looked up to in the church. They were the family that whenever someone had a need, they were able to give. They were there to help. They had the means, they had the heart, they had the ability, and so they were always there. They were the family that was always there helping others. And then a tragedy struck their family. A bad accident. And a number of their family members were hurt, and one of them was killed. Suddenly, they were the ones in need. Before, they had been able to give to everyone, provide for others in need, but now they were in need, and what they needed, they didn't have in themselves in this lowest moment of their life. And so people from church gathered around and surrounded them and supported them and encouraged them and grieved with them and helped them. And their comment was this: we didn't know how to do that. We didn't know how to receive. We didn't know how to respond. We didn't know what do you do when people come and offer help? What do you do? It's like we were always the ones going to others and offering help. And so it's good for us to be reminded that everything that we have received. We have been given. God has blessed us. And when we lose sight of that, Paul says, why do you boast as though you did it? Why do you boast as if you did it on your own? Have you lost sight of the fact that you received it? And if you did, who did you receive it from? You boast as though you did not, as though you earned it on your own, as if you are the Corinthian church, the Christian light in the community, on your own, because of you're such wonderful people. Paul then says in verses 8 through 13, rather snarkily, rather sarcastically, by doing this you have degraded the gospel. You have lessened its importance. You have made it less valuable. When in fact for the church, the gospel is the most precious gift that we have. The most valued thing. The treasure that we should guard with our life. You have demeaned it. He says, you have become kings, but you've done it without us. And he says, how I wish that we could have been kings together. It seems to me that God has put us as the apostles on display at the end of the procession. You have made us spectacles. In the times of Rome, when there was persecution of the church, they would get rid of the lesser members, and they would do that by means. But ultimately, at the end, there would be a parade to puff up Rome and the Roman leaders and the Roman authorities, and at the end of the parade would come the leaders of the people that were being persecuted. They would be the last ones to go into the arena, and they would be destroyed by lions or gladiators or other people, and they were the spectacle. They were the reason everybody came to watch. And so Paul says it's like we're the spectacles. It's like everybody is coming and watching to see that we have failed. You seem to be strong and we look like we're weak. We have suffered and people say things about us and we respond in kind words and all these things are happening to us. We work hard with our hands. But yet, we're treated like the refuse of the world, like something that can just be cast off, like the waste. It goes in the garbage can. It gets picked up by the sanitation department on Wednesdays and Sundays. Paul says, you have devalued the gospel. You've lost sight of who you are and why you were here. You've lost your humility. And you're leading the church down a path that God has not intended for you. You've lost sight of who you are, and you've begun to look at yourself and others through your own eyes and not through the eyes of Christ. You've lost sight of the purpose, which is greater than taking care of self. The purpose of church, the purpose of being a child of God, the purpose of being part of God's family is to, not for ourselves, but it's to, if I remember right, it's to love God above all, to serve God above all, and then to love our neighbors, secondly, as we love ourselves. To love God and to love our neighbor. To serve God and to serve our neighbor. Well, where does self come into that? And you notice that Paul is saying the Corinthian church has elevated self to number one. Now, that's another thing I see in church. I talk to people and they'll say, how's your church going? Well, it's going, God is blessing us. It's going well. And they'll say, well, you know, we attended Church A. I won't give it a name. And we went there for years. But we just weren't getting anything out of it anymore. We always went home and it's like, why did we go there? Why do we do this every week? We just felt, oh. And so we decided to go to Church B. Our friend said, come over to Church B. We're an excited group. We are. And so we went to Church B, and you know, when I go home, I'm all excited. I feel like, oh man, this is great. Do we go to church for ourselves? Are we here today so that we can go home saying, oh, thank you. I just needed that, and I feel so much better about myself. Sort of like when we go to have a, well, ladies, when they go to have a pedicure, right? When you look down at your toes and you, oh, look at them nice toes. I feel so much better about myself. Is that why we go to church? No, that's not why we go. We go to honor God, to give God praise, and in our giving we are blessed, in our giving we receive. But see, they were going to receive, to receive something. And they weren't honoring God. They had lost sight of the purpose. They forgot that they were to be heralds of the cross, heralds of the gospel, faithful servants of the gospel. And remember, Paul said this in the very beginning. He said, It is required that those who have been given a trust must be proved faithful. And Paul says these words again in 2 Timothy. When he writes these words to Timothy to encourage him, he says, "And of this gospel I was a herald, an apostle, and a teacher. That is why I am suffering as I am, and I am not ashamed, because I know that whom I have believed, and I am convinced of, that he is able to guard that which I have entrusted to him for that day." Now, what did Paul say he had entrusted to God? "I know whom I have believed, and I am convinced that he will guard what I have entrusted to him for that day." What day is he talking about? Paul is talking about Judgment Day. Paul is talking about the final day when he stands before the judge. And he is saying, "I know that the one who died for me, the one who is the judge, Jesus Christ himself, that he will guard and protect my life. My life is in his hands. And so I will trust that he will protect that." Okay? "I have entrusted my life to him. My life is yours." And we sing the song, "In my life, Lord, be glorified. My life is in your hands, so may my life be an honor to you and may you be glorified in it." And then Paul says these words, "What you have heard from me, keep as the pattern of sound teaching with faith and love in Christ Jesus." And again, he uses these words, "Guard the good deposit, the trust, that has been entrusted to you. Guard it with the help of the Holy Spirit who lives in us." Guard the good deposit. Guard the trust that has been entrusted to you. So we have entrusted our lives to God. And what has God entrusted us with? What is the treasure that's in the clay pot that Paul talks about? Which is the most important thing, even though we worry about our clay pot a little too much? What is the most important thing that God has given to us? It's the gospel. It's the story of Jesus. It's Jesus Christ himself. And he says, whatever you do, guard the gospel. Protect the truth of who Jesus is. And you also are to be heralds and apostles and teachers of the gospel. You are to be leaders. And so Paul is saying that they have failed. They have failed to be faithful servants of the gospel. And he says in the last part of the text, "For the kingdom of God is not a matter of talk, but of power." The kingdom of God is not a matter of talk. It's not simply a matter of words. Now let me explain this a little bit. When God spoke at the beginning of time in Genesis 1, God said, "Let there be light," and there was light. For 6 days, God spoke, and whatever he said came to be. His word brought life. Then in John 1, it says, "In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God." And so Jesus became a human being, and the Word became flesh and dwelt among us, full of grace and full of truth. And so when Jesus came as the Word, and he offered his life as a sacrifice, and as he was raised from the dead, he also brought life, new life, a new life, a changed world that is no longer shackled by Satan and sin and the curse of sin. And so when God says something, all he has to do is say it. But that's not true for us. I know that I'm a pastor. And people tell me that pastors like to talk. They like to use their words. And I'll admit that I probably talk a little too much. I did that before I was a pastor too. But there are others as well that we talk. And we think that our words simply are going to make a difference. But our words are without power if they aren't words that are connected to Christ and if we aren't serving Christ with our words. And so let me give you an example. Someone comes and tells you a problem in their life. And you say, I'm so sorry. I'm so sorry that you're dealing with that's happening in your life. And so I will pray for you. And the person says, thank you. And you part ways. And you never pray for them. You forget. Now take another time when someone comes and tells you a problem and you say, let me pray with you, and you pray with them right then and there. Now tell me, is there more power in that? Does something happen when we do that? As opposed to when we say, I'll pray for you, and then we go on our way. Nothing happens. And so when we say words, and I'm guilty of this, when I went into ministry, I would assume that I always had to be of help, be the everything for them. And so I would tell people, I'll give you a call. I'll visit you next week. Well, when I looked at my schedule, when I got home and looked at my schedule for next week, there was no time. And so I didn't visit him next week, and the following week I didn't either. And then later the person would say, well, you told me you were going to visit me, but I never saw you. Again, if we tell someone we're going to do something, it's better that we do it. Because it's in doing it with God's help that the blessing, that the power is extended, is poured out. Words simply by themselves don't make a difference. It's when our actions follow our words, when they work together. And so Paul is saying, your words are empty. And so we've seen the problem, not only in Corinth, but in our life. And so now I want to talk about the grace. In verse 4, he says, I come here with a clear conscience. You have failed. Paul says, I have failed. But I come with a clear conscience because I have been striving to do what Jesus Christ has called me to do. And so I am more than a conqueror. The one who is going to judge me is Jesus Christ himself, the one who died for me. And so I trust that his righteousness will cover me. When we serve God with faith in Christ, we're not going to be perfect at it. None of us are. In fact, that's why we shouldn't judge each other, because none of us are better than the other. And we shouldn't be puffed up. But we should all go to God with a clear conscience, knowing that we have done our best, that we have been faithful in what God has called us to do. In verse 5, he says, when he's talking about them judging, he says, God will come when the Lord comes, and he will bring light. What is hidden in the darkness will be exposed, and all the motives of man's heart will be seen. Oh my goodness. Can I hide now? Can I crawl under the table? Because when that light exposes what the hidden places of my heart, I really don't want to see it, and I'm sure God doesn't want to see it. And so you would think that God would come and say, but notice what Paul says. Paul says, At that time, each will receive his praise from God. Wait a minute. Wait a minute. I thought I was in trouble, but I'm not. I thought I was going to get punished, but I'm not. I'm going to get praised. That's God's love and grace. I've told you before that whenever you turn and you look to God and look into his eyes, you will see a God who is showing you love, loving eyes. That's the thing that I remember the most about when our children were little. When they're, 2 months old, and they started recognizing your voice, and they could see better, and you'd hold them and talk to them, and they'd look in your eyes, and they would just smile. They would just smile. Unless, of course, they wanted something. But those moments when they smiled at you, they recognized your voice, they knew that you loved them, and they were trying to show you their love for you in whatever way they could. That's the kind of eyes that God gives us, eyes of love. No matter the situation, when we turn to him and acknowledge that he is the God who forgives us, he will look at us with eyes of love. And then in verse 8, he says, you already have all you want and all you need. You have been enriched. You lack nothing. You have been put into fellowship with Christ Jesus himself. You lack nothing. Everything you need has been given to you. All that you could want, God has given you through Christ Jesus. And he says, God has sent me to be your father. And so I'm going to send Timothy to help. Now, Father's Day is coming up, not too long, and we'll celebrate fathers. But today I want to just mention briefly that men are men regardless of what they do. We are born male or female, and so a man is a man no matter what he does. He doesn't have to do something macho to be a man, right? A man can be a husband if he marries a woman and takes her to himself to be his wife. And so then a man can be a husband. But a man can only be a father. Is the only time a man can be a father is when he brings life into the world, when he contributes and brings something to life. So a man and a woman come together, they conceive, and the mother carries the child, and a child is born, and together man and woman have become one in this new life. And so Paul said, I came here, and what I gave to you brought new life. And that new life means that we can be imitators of Christ. Okay. Leadership. What does that have to do with leadership? Looks like it's all on you, Pastor. We expect you to be the leader, our fearless leader, and so it's all on you. No, it's not all on me. We're the church together. And so, as I lead, you also lead. As Christ leads me, Christ leads you. And one of the roles of our of being set apart to be leaders is to lead others to Christ. To guard the gospel. Not only to guard it, but to share it, to spread it, because that's what it was intended to be. Something that is shared, something that is spread. Now you say, Pastor, I can't do that. can't do that. I get all nervous and my tongue sticks to the roof of my mouth and no sound comes out and I just look stupid. No. When that opportunity comes, God will give you the words. God will give you the strength. Because you have been set apart to be leaders. Leaders in the church, leaders in your home, leaders in the community. And the way we lead is by imitating Christ and by proclaiming Him as Lord. And telling the truth of the gospel. What does the gospel mean to us? Well, it means that when Jesus returns, I'm going to be able to go on this side and all the bad people are going to go on the other side. No, there's much more to the gospel than that. The gospel means that we have new life and new life to share. The gospel means that our life is different today, tomorrow. The gospel means that for Petra and Jordan who are graduating, as they enter into the big world, God has a plan for them, a purpose for them. And that purpose is going to be beautiful because it's, if they follow God, He's going to be glorified and they're going to be blessed. So the gospel means to us that we have been set apart to be leaders. And God has given us all that we need to be leaders. God has given us the example. God has given us someone to help us, the Holy Spirit. God has given us the means. And so, our calling is to be leaders. It amazes me continually that God entrusted us, human beings, stubborn, weak, prone to be distracted, but He entrusted us to build His kingdom. You and I. He entrusted us to build His kingdom. Now, God's kingdom, an eternal kingdom, a kingdom that has ramifications for everybody's life. And He entrusted us. But He said, I'll go with you. I'll help you. As you follow my lead, you also will lead. As I have led you, so will you lead others to me. And so the rise and the fall of every good business depends on good leadership. The rise and the fall of Christ's church depends on good leaders. Myself and you as well. May we be the leaders God has called us to be and set us apart to be. In Jesus' name, amen. Father in heaven, we come to you this morning and we thank you for leading us to this place where we have contentment, to this place where we have hope, to this place we find joy in our life. A mysterious joy that is found in you. But Lord, we pray that as you have given us this blessing, that we may be a people who don't simply hide it under a bushel or put it into a glass jar or bury it in our backyard for safekeeping, but that it may be something that we share. As we have been led by your love and by others in our life, may we also be people who lead others to you. May we be those who direct by our life, by our words, by our actions. May we direct others to the love of Jesus Christ, because they see the love of Christ at work in us. And so thank you for calling us and setting us apart for such a purpose, for building up your kingdom. And Lord, may we be faithful with what you have entrusted us with. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.